Gang, I consider myself to be a fairly even-tempered guy. When the world is bound and determined to descend to every circle of Dante's Inferno in chronological order, you have to be even-tempered, or you have to make your peace with the horde of non-diverse ulcers that are going to take up residence in your stomach. But sometimes, the abject evil of the world pulls a new one on you, and you just want to go full Conan the Barbarian on society for allowing us to reach the point that we're at. And what is that point, I hear you asking from the other side of my screen? Well, on May 28th, just in time for June, which has now become our most appropriated month for all colors of the rainbow and for all manner of letters in the alphabet, Blue's Clues, which is ostensibly a children's show where a blue CGI dog teaches kids around the ages of 3 and 5, ostensibly preschool things like the alphabet and basic numbers, did this.
Hey, Blue, look at all these families.
Hi, families.
It's time for a pride parade.
Families marching one by one, hurrah, hurrah. Families marching one by one, hurrah, hurrah. This family has two mommies, they love each other so proudly, and they all go marching in the big parade. Families marching two by two, hurrah, hurrah. Families marching two by two, hurrah, hurrah. This family has two daddies, they love each other so proudly, and they all go marching in the big parade. Come on, friends! Families marching three by three, hurrah, hurrah. Families marching three by three, hurrah, hurrah. These papas are non-binary, they love each other so proudly, and they all go marching in the big parade. Families marching four by four, hurrah.
That was only a minute of the full thing, FYI. And this isn't even the first time that Blue's Clues has gone full SJW wanker on the kids. Back in February, Sammy Chan, one of the writers of the show, made P stand for Pride in the requisite alphabet song, stating on Twitter that he wanted to make it as diverse and inclusive as possible, quote unquote. But Blue's Clues is only the tip of the proverbial perverted iceberg, gang. The Walt Disney Company has gone from Walt Disney's vision of being a studio that brought wonder, joy, and imagination to millions of children to becoming just another avenue where those same children can receive overdoses of right-think regarding sexuality. Some time ago, I made a whole video about Disney Pixar's short Out, which was historic because it featured the first out and proud gay main character who finally gets the courage to tell his parents that he has a boyfriend after he and his dog switch bodies, switch minds, switch souls. In any event, it was a plot point that made the plot of The Rescuers look like a documentary. The fact that Art, a side character in the company's latest live-action abomination Cruella, is also part of the Rainbow Coalition is a point of pride that's supposed to make us all gush over how wonderful the finished product is, something that I objectively refuse to do. And if you want all the gory details about that, I highly recommend you watch the Critical Drinkers review. And these are not aberrations, by the way, gang. Disney has made it quite clear that this is the way of the future, and you can get with the program and like it. Disney is naturally the big kahuna here, but it's by far the only example. Reboots of He-Man, She-Ra, Rugrats, Clifford the Big Red Dog have all made their obeisance to the rainbow flag. Heck, even Netflix's adaptation of The Babysitter's Club has followed suit, with the entire plot of the fourth episode of the first season being about a boy who insists that he's a girl, leaving it to our intrepid hero Marianne to set the straight privileged doctors straight.
Have him change into this.
I don't want the blue one.
I hear someone's not feeling well. Let's take a look at the little man.
Can I please talk to you two outside? I know that you guys are busy, but as you would see, if you looked at her and not her chart, Bailey is not a boy. And by treating her like one, you are completely ignoring who she is. You're making her feel insignificant and humiliated. And that's not going to help her feel good or safe or calm.
This doesn't even touch on how education, from history and literature to even math, has been co-opted by the sexual ideologues, who now see enlightening your children as to their practically non-existent hormones as their sacred duty, far more important than teaching them asinine things like who Americans fought in the American Revolution or how much 6 times 6 makes. And if you're thinking at this point that the various strands of the culture, including those that are deliberately made and aimed at your children, seem to be working overtime to sexualize them, and while the perpetrator could be any one of a dozen different suspects, the degeneration of the Western family, the collapse of religion in the West, blatant commercialism, one of the most glaring and obvious is Pride Month itself. Gang, we are far and away from the days when activists told us that it was just about love, acceptance, and diversity. Now, we have been spun a complete 180 degrees, with activists now telling us in our face that, yeah, it's all about the sex and the kink. In 2018, The Advocate reminded its readers that the parade featuring naked muscle men and bizarre costumes, the more fetishized the better, it's about sex. Not love, not acceptance, not diversity per se, but sex. The San Francisco Examiner declared this May that kink totally belongs at Pride, which has now become a melting pot where you'll be able to find whatever it is you're looking for. Maybe in an unwashed back alley, but you'll be able to find it. And if you're a self-respecting parent who's actually made it to this point in the video, you might be thinking, okay, things are a little racier now than they were 10 years ago. Parental guidance is advised. That is exactly the opposite message that's being sent. 3 years ago, the Huffington Post ran an entire piece in which the case was made that kink and kids go together like peanut butter and jelly. There is absolutely no reason not to take our kids to Pride. It's a fun day, there are a lot of bubbles, rainbow streamers, and enjoyable performances, writer, educator, and publisher S. Bear Bergman told HuffPost Canada. Plus, as queer parents, it's one of their cultural festivals, added Bergman, who attends Toronto Pride every year with his kids. It's their right as queer spawn, and as a parent, I might want to take my kids to Pride because they might be lesbian, gay, bi, trans, queer, or two-spirit. Just this year, Ruth Schneider penned an entire column for the Eureka Times Standard in which she made the case in all seriousness that kink and pride go together like love and marriage, horse and carriage, and that kids are entirely welcome to this skin fest. If a parent takes a child to Pride, it falls on the parent to be willing to explain kinks to children. And honestly, it's not that hard. Whether it's BDSM or furries, all one has to say is that it's adult dress-up and redirect the kid to other things. She also implicitly calls out anyone who might non-offensively, half-heartedly raise their hand in questioning of this logic by saying that the kink and the leather that kids can see at Pride is exactly the same as the G-rated stuff that is actually made for children. If we look at what is acceptable that is G-rated, it creates a very different picture of what is acceptable in modern culture. Let's take, for example, Disney movies. In The Little Mermaid, a teenage girl gives up her voice to look human to be attractive to a boy. In Beauty and the Beast, a man-turned-beast holds a girl captive in order to open his heart to love. Pocahontas features an underage Native American woman who marries a much older man. Never mind that Ruth has apparently never even seen some of these Disney movies. Pocahontas does not marry John Smith, for example, in Disney's retelling of that story. These are fairy tales! They are works of the imagination that are meant to guide children to greater transcendental truths. They're not twerking in front of your kid and calling it liberation. What gets me madder than a conquistador looking at the stacked skulls alongside an Aztec altar and all this, gang, isn't the propaganda, funnily enough. We're swimming in propaganda 24/7. That's the norm now, until a cultural jihad actually reclaims society and gets us back to some semblance of normality. No, what makes me mad is that these wankers are actively stealing the innocence of children. Childhood innocence is often regarded as a disadvantage that children have. Because they're innocent, the poor little dears don't know how the world works, which is why we've taken it upon ourselves to take away their innocence as soon as possible. Preschool sex ed classes, for example. But the innocence of children isn't a debilitation, and it isn't just an extra added appendage to that stage of life. It is an integral part of childhood. We often think of children's innocence as being their ability to see what isn't there. castles in the clouds, dwarves in stumps, and fairy rings in roughly circular patterns of mushrooms and various other fungi, but this gets everything exactly backwards. Childhood innocence doesn't allow children to see what isn't there, it allows them to see what actually is. We adults can become so engrossed in the day-to-day grind of our lives that we start to think that what we sense is the end-all and be-all of reality. Even if we're religious, we can fall into this trap. We forget that what we see, taste, touch, hear is only a small part of reality as a whole. And you don't even have to believe in fairies or witches to believe in that. Platonists, for example, believed in a higher, separate plane of reality, the realm of the forms, of which everything on earth was simply a copy. For example, your dog, according to Platonism, is only a dog because it is actively participating in the form of dog that resides in the realm of the form. And the form of dog, FYI, is the only real dog that actually exists. All the other dogs here on Earth that we see every day being simply imitators of this real dog. And even though we couldn't see or sense this higher realm, we could only intellectually deduce it from the forms that surround us here on Earth, it was not an allegory or a visualization like the allegory of the cave or the story of Gyros's ring. No, it was as real and as concrete a part of reality as the mountains or the ocean. My man Aristotle, though he departed from Plato's idea as to the nature of the forms, absolutely believed that they existed, holding that forms were the animating principle of things here on Earth, thereby giving everything that we see around us a spiritual or at the very least a transcendental aspect that is invisible to the naked eye. And even if the old philosophy masters aren't exactly your cup of tea, if you believe that truth, goodness, beauty, order, justice, mercy, even evil, are actual realities and not just nominalist labels, then you too believe that there is more to life, more to reality, than simply the four walls of a materialistic prison. In an essay entitled On Household Gods and Goblins, published in 1922, G.K. Chesterton, the British writer and apologist, illuminated this point by saying, quote, "The nomad and the anarchist accuse the domestic ideal of being merely timid and prim. But this is not because they themselves are bolder or more vigorous, but simply because they do not know it well enough to know how bold and vigorous it is. The most obvious example is the hearth, which is the heart of the home. A man living in the lukewarm air of centrally heated hotels may be said to have never seen fire. Compared to him, the housewife at the fireside is an Amazon wrestling with a flaming dragon. The same moral might be drawn from the fact that the watchdog fights while the wild dog often runs away. Of the husband, as of the house dog, it may often be said that he has been tamed into ferocity. This is especially true of the sort of house represented by the country cottage. It is only in theory that the things are petty and prosaic. A man realistically experiencing them will feel them to be things big and baffling and involving a heavy battle with nature. When we read about cabbages or cauliflowers in the papers, and especially the comic papers, we learn to think of them as commonplace. But if a man of any imagination will merely consent to walk round the kitchen garden for himself, and really looks at cabbages and cauliflowers, he will feel at once that they are vast and elemental things like the mountains and the clouds. He will feel something almost monstrous about the size and solidity of the things swelling out of that small and tidy patch of ground." This is why, in a very real sense, gang, men of the ancient and still despised medieval world, who believed in witches, saw ghosts, and protected himself from the she, was much freer than we are today. Man, before modernity, had not educated himself to the point of blindness regarding the largeness of reality. To paraphrase Chesterton again, to men of the ancient world, wine wasn't simply a drink, it was also a god, which is actually much more accurate in its inaccuracy regarding its nature than we are today in our scientific precision over what exactly it is. Children, because life hasn't poured into their heads quite yet, the fashions they're supposed to hold sacred, the truths they're supposed to despise, the friends they're supposed to have, the joy and wonder of the 24/7 news cycle, can still see the god in the wine, the spirit in the wind, the little people in the trees, all of which, gang, are simply symbols and mythologized figures for the larger transcendental truths that are part of reality, but stand behind the veil of materialism. Their innocence allows them to see life fully. Which honestly is one of the main reasons why the Gnostics, who run the culture at the moment, want to steal it away from them. When your goal is to get people to reject reality for a secondary reality of your choosing, which is the end goal of all Gnostics, then you can't have people running around who have the ability to see life for what it truly is. After all, that might glitch the entire narrative. No, best not to take any chances. Best instead to rob that ability from them as soon as possible and gussy it up as liberation and inclusivity. There's another reason as well, gang. If children can become propagators of the ideology, then you can make them the perfect soldiers of the ideology. Let's just be honest here for a second. Who really wants to tell the 5-year-old boy who insists he's a girl, because his parents and teachers and everyone else tells him he's a girl because he happens to like pink, that he's not a girl but is actually a boy, that his body screams the fact that he is a boy? Who wants to tell the 15-year-old girl that it's perfectly normal for her to be attracted to boys when her friends, teachers, and the culture at large have told her that being a girl who likes boys is just another way of being an oppressor? No one does, because everyone knows how that confrontation is going to go down, especially when it inevitably gets out on social media. If you can fill children's heads with the ideology, turn them into the equivalent of the Ottoman Janissaries, Christian boys from the Balkan, forcibly removed from their families, their culture, their religion, forcibly converted to Islam, and then trained in Constantinople to become the perfect loyal fighting machines of the Sultan, you have gained an awesome weapon for your cause. They want zombie soldiers, gang, and they want your kids to be the zombies. It's an evil system which cannot be compromised with, reasoned with, or tolerated. It has to be destroyed, utterly and completely, with not one stone standing upon another.
And I don't know about you, gang, but after that, I definitely need a silver lining.
So always look for the silver lining and try to find the sunny side of life.
And the silver lining this time around, gang, is the Western novel Monty Walsh by Jack Schaefer, which actually began life as a series of short stories, but which were woven together into novel form by Schaefer in 1963. And now some of you might be saying at this point, Nate, I hate Westerns. Can't stand them. I don't want to read another cliched story about how the chosen cowboy has to slap leather against the evil cattle baron at high noon on the main street of Laredo in order to save the town and at the same time win the heart of the pretty school teacher from back east. Well, then I come, gang, with tidings of comfort and joy, because Monty Walsh eschews all of those cliches, and really eschews most of the cliches that we have come to associate with Westerns, especially in cinematic form. It's not a story about cattle rustlers and cowboys and yodeling under the full sky of the Old West. No, it is a story instead about a man who learns a trade that he loves, and then who lives out that trade and lives out a way of life while that way of life and the world that he has always known, the world of the Old West, disappears right in front of his eyes. It is a tale of manhood. It is a tale of friendship. It is a tale of hardship. It is a tale where time inexorably takes its toll on our heroes, plain, ordinary, everyday people like you and me, who have absolutely nothing special about them except the work and grit and guts that they have and the pride that they take in their work. I recommend that you read it in novel form, of course, but I also recommend that you listen to it, I should say, in the audiobook version that is narrated by Eric P. Dove. I myself have made it a personal tradition to listen to that audiobook version every year around this time of year. May, June is when I start, and I just actually finished it for the fourth time in a row straight. And it's one of those books, gang, where no matter how many times you read it or listen to it, you always pick up something more. You always come away from it with something more than when you started reading it again. Monty Walsh by Jack Schaefer, gang. Read it, listen to it, you will never forget it, and I want to guarantee that you will love it. It's one of my favorite novels of all time. Well, that about wraps up everything for this time around, gang. As always, if you liked the video, whether you agreed with me or not, show your support by giving it a like, sharing it with your friends on social media, and leaving me a comment below. And if you like videos about culture, politics, and religion from a unique POV, then make sure to ring that bell like Quasimodo so that you will always know when I put new videos like this on the channel, videos that you are not going to want to miss. As always, thank you for watching, for giving me a bit of your day, and thank you to everyone who has already subscribed to my channel. I appreciate every single one of you from the bottom of my heart. And until next time, gang, stay safe and stay free by daring to read, think, speak, and write. I will talk to you again shortly. Ciao.